We're in our third part of this series on core values of the church. So 3 weeks ago, Blake was here, preached for us, and he talked about that we value relationships that result in discipleship. Part of God's plan for all of us is that we stay connected with each other, and that through our connections, we grow stronger in God. Now, there are a lot of ways that that can happen, and it can be formal or informal. A lot of the mentoring of the New Testament era was typically more informal than it was a formal plan or place through there. Can be both. But one of the ways that you grow in your spiritual development is through a smaller group environment, such as the classes that we have on Sunday morning at 9:30, the classes that are Wednesday at 7, and then community groups that happen typically on Sunday night around 6 o'clock. Those are all ways that we can grow in our discipleship and connect with each other and encourage each other on. Then last week we talked about this, we value the Word of God. I gave you some things last week that you could take home with you that had how long it takes to read each book of the Bible, that had a little synopsis of what's in each book of the Bible, and hopefully that has helped you this week. Hopefully you read the Word of God. We talked about reading it 4 times a week will help you in your spiritual development. All of these things come together. None of them are isolated, but we grow together through relationship. We grow together through obedience to God's word. And this morning I want to talk about we are devoted to prayer. Now this morning I'm going to do something I don't think I've ever done before. That's a pretty big statement because I've been doing this a while. More than me talking to you for 30 or 35 minutes about, okay, or 40 minutes, about how to pray, we're actually going to pray today. This is going to be a prayer session that I lead with you. I'm going to give you a few things up front just quickly for some background of information. Then if I don't know what we have and what we do anymore, I hope that you got a prayer guide on your way in, but I'm seeing a lot of people not holding one, and you need that. It will help you immensely. I think you can find it on your phone. If you go to the app, I believe somebody helped me out with the yes, thumbs up, nod, if that's right. It's on the app. It's also on the website if you go to wasofirst.com, or if you want a paper copy, is there somebody that can help hand some out, or they're in the back? And yeah, I think we're okay to hand them out now. I think we're past some of those kind of things. If you don't want to have someone hand it to you, you can get up and walk back and get one, I guess. But if you have a copy of some of it, it's going to help you in a minute. Let me talk about prayer for just a moment. The one thing I want to encourage you today is to do this, to develop a devotion to prayer. And that's what we value. It's not just an occasional prayer, but people who are devoted to prayer, where it is your go-to, it is the foundation of life, your connection with God. In Romans chapter 12, in verse 12, there's a long list of things that Paul tells us to do that are kind of one-sentence shots. And one of the ones he says there in verse 12 is this. He encourages us to be devoted to prayer. Now, the Greek word for devoted there, it could be translated different ways. It could be called be constant in prayer, be faithful in prayer. And the word devotion is a good word for that. The same Greek word is used in Mark 3:9 for devotion. The same Greek word is used where Jesus tells his disciples to have a boat ready. That thought means to have a boat that is devoted for my use. How many of you like when you have a reservation at a restaurant, and it's a restaurant where they know how to operate and they do reservations well, and you walk through a packed out lobby and you say, I have a reservation, and they say, right this way. Here's what they are saying. There is a table that has been designated, devoted for your use. Now, tables just sit there. They don't move. They don't do anything. They are inanimate objects. We, on the other hand, are living, breathing people. Everybody put your hand in front of your mouth and make sure you still got breath. You're okay. If you don't feel anything, we need to get you some help. We're living, breathing people. Our devotion is not a passive devotion like the table, sitting, just waiting. Our devotion is an active devotion to advance God's kingdom and to accomplish his will. Throughout scripture, you'll find this word for devotion, this Greek word for devotion, about 10 times in the New Testament. And listen to this. 5 of the times that it is there, it speaks of prayer. That's pretty powerful. This word is primarily used in the New Testament as a call to be devoted to prayer. Not just throwing a prayer up when you're about to have a car wreck. There's nothing wrong with that. It's okay to cry out for Jesus, but it'll be a whole lot better if you were talking to him before you got there. Acts 1:14 speaks of Jesus ascending, and it says this, these all were with one mind and were continually devoting themselves to prayer. Acts 2:42, a passage we're very familiar with, says they were content, list four things they were devoted to, the last one being prayer. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Acts 6:4, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. That's what the apostles said. Colossians 4:2, devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving. Boy, that says a lot about prayer right there, doesn't it? Devote yourself to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving. I think it's very obvious to say that from the New Testament scriptures that the normal Christian life is a life devoted to prayer. Now, I'm not saying that to make you feel guilty. I'm not saying that so that you'll look at your life and go, wow, I'm a loser today. That's what the devil always tries to do to us. I'm encouraging you to know that you have the power of the Holy Spirit resident within you if you are a child of God, and he will help you if you will just take the step of obedience to walk in the way he's calling you. So why should we pray? Well, there's many, many reasons. The most important one is this, because the Bible tells us to pray and we need to do whatever God says. That's last week, obedience to the word. Another reason we need to pray is because in our world today, the needs that we face as individuals, as families, as churches, as missions efforts go forth, the needs that we face, they are huge and they are desperate. And we can't just give a little complimentary prayer of God bless all the missionaries everywhere. Amen? We need to pray with intensity. A third reason, and maybe most important, is because God acts when we pray. Scripture tells us over and over and over again that is the case. When you look at the word prayer, and by the way, here is your assignment for this week with obeying the word of God. I want you to read the book of Acts this week. It should take you about 2 hours and 15 minutes according to the chart. Now, if you're reading slower and you're taking note of certain words, it may take you a little bit longer, and that's perfectly fine. If you're a fast reader, you may be a little quicker, but that's kind of an approximation. And I want you to look for the word pray, prayer, prayed, some form of that word. And I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to find it in the book of Acts with 28 chapters, a little over 30 times. It's the most of any book using the word prayer in the Bible, except for Psalms, which is 150 collections of poetry that speak primarily as a prayer and song book. But other than that, the word pray or prayer or prayed is most often used in the book of Acts. That tells me this, that the New Testament church believed and practiced prayer as part of their regular activity. By the way, when did they pray? Well, they prayed when they were selecting leaders. They prayed when there was a crisis. They prayed when they were repenting. They prayed when they were saying goodbye. They prayed when they were waiting. They prayed. When did they not pray? That's probably a easier question to ask, because the answer is going to be this. They prayed continually. What happened when they prayed? Well, when they prayed, the church moved forward. When they prayed, God poured out his spirit. Prayer is a key. You'll see the word prayer about 31, 32 times. You'll see 19 different times when they are praying, and 9 of those times are in a corporate setting. I want to encourage you to come and be with us when we pray every month on a Wednesday at 6 o'clock, and I think we can have it set up this way. We actually have a little food here for you if you didn't get a chance to eat. If you want to do that, if you don't want to eat, you don't have to. It's an optional thing, and that starts at about 5:45. And whenever you're done with that, I'm going to encourage you to come in the room and just to begin to pray to yourself, to the Lord, by yourself to the Lord. And then at about 6:15, we'll move it to more of a corporate prayer for about 30 minutes. That's the first Wednesday of every month. We normally have a prayer group that meets either on Sunday morning or Wednesday night, and I encourage you to find that out and be a part of that. And if you want prayer resources, we have them on our webpage. We can get them for you, more than you can read in your lifetime. Let's talk about prayer now and get your guide out, and we're going to pray this morning. We're going to start, first of all, acknowledging God for who he is. We're going to give praise and worship to him in our prayer, even as we have done with our songs earlier. Now we're going to do it through our prayer moment. If you'll look on your handout there on the second page, there are some more things that are listed there that speak to the thought of the nature of God, who he is, and how we can reach out to him. The word that we see for today's date on the 25th is the word El Shaddai. The word means God Almighty. It's actually used about 50 times, primarily in the Old Testament. It is a picture of the God who pours out blessing, the God who has all sufficiency, more than enough. It is the God who has abundant supply, and there are different ways the word could be looked at, but it's the one who delights in pouring out blessing upon his children. He gives us what we need. Aren't you glad that he is the all-sufficient God, the God of all power, the God who has everything that we need? There is nothing hard for him. There's nothing difficult for him. There's no provision beyond his capacity. See, here's the good news about me for you. I wish I could give all of you $1 million here today. I just have one problem. I don't have the provision for that. God is willing and able. Whatever your needs are, he will help you. And often in my prayer for people when they're going through difficulty, my prayer often goes like this: God, I pray that you would reveal your presence to them and surround them with your presence so that in you they will find peace, they will find comfort, they will find joy, they will find provision, because all of those things are not out there loosely floating around. They're all connected to the Father. They're all connected to the God El Shaddai, who is more than enough, the one who meets all of our needs. Well, this is going to be a prayer time, so I want you to stand to your feet again with me. I want you to lift your hands, as the Bible tells us to do, encouraging us in Psalms, and then Paul also to Timothy. I wish that men would lift up holy hands in worship to God. And I want you right now to say, God, I thank you that you are more than enough. Every need that I have, you will meet. I praise you, God. Now, in your own words, all across the room, would you just give praise to the one who pours out blessing upon you? I thank you, God, that you bring healing when we are sick. I thank you, God, that you bring understanding when we are confused. I thank you, God, that you bring salvation when we are lost. And everything you provide, God, is more than enough. The work of Jesus Christ covered all of our sins, brought us to a place of restoration. God, I worship you, for you are worthy of all praise. You're worthy of glory and honor. You are the God El Shaddai, who is more than enough, who is the all-sufficient one. We bless you, God. Are you glad for who he is? How about giving him praise right now? We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We worship you, Jesus. You can be seated. I would encourage you, get that monthly prayer guide, and depending on how much you feel the need to worship Lord, the Lord, and how much you, the more you worship God, that's going to have a positive impact on your, on you. There's a lot of ways to say this, but when you begin to praise him, your view of life changes. And you can go through all 31 in one day if you want to. If today's the 25th, but you want to do the one that's on the 17th, that's okay. There are no rules. We're just trying to provide you with 31 things you can praise God for. And you've got at least one for every day. And if it's February, you can do two a day three times or do them all every day. Let's go to the next section, and we're going to pray for our world. You probably don't have it in here with you, but if you did, the Kingdom Partners book that we have, they're available out front by the missions wall, and there's always a mission story playing every Sunday out there. You can take a moment to stop and look at that. Eurasia covers a lot of countries. I think we have a picture of it we're going to put on the screen for you, I believe. There you go. All that's colored is Eurasia. So let me kind of walk, all of it's Eurasia. The gray part's Eurasia too. Starts down in the corner of North Africa, over in Morocco, goes across Algeria. I know you can't read it, but I'm just telling you what's there. Libya, Egypt, then going all the way up in to Estonia, all the way across Russia, down through Iran, Iraq, all the stands are there. India, Nepal, all the way down to Sri Lanka. There are 44 countries. Many of them suffer persecution for their faith. I think we all understand that. We're talking about a lot of the Middle East, where there's a strong Muslim influence, and the Christian faith is often not tolerated. But yet the church is growing. The Spirit of God is being poured out. It might help you and bless you to know that there is an Assembly of God Bible College in Tehran. Jesus said, I will build my church. Forgive me for being a little bit colloquial with my terminology here, but he didn't stutter, he didn't stammer, he didn't pause. He said, I will build my church. It's not a might, it's not maybe, he will build it. And he wanted to make sure we understood how determined he was and how there's nothing in the world that could ever stop it, because he made this statement after he said, I will build my church. He said, and even the very gates of hell will not stand against it. You need to understand something there. Gates don't move. Gates don't attack. Gates are what we attack. And we push back darkness. We are the aggressor against the enemy. We don't cower in the corner. We go in the power of the name of Jesus, the strength of the Holy Spirit, and we believe for salvation to occur in Owosso, across Oklahoma, across our nation, and around the world. God, bring people into your kingdom. And in that dark portion of the world, these numbers are staggering. In Eurasia, there's almost 2.7 billion people. Let me help you out with this. million to billion, because it's just kind of whatever. If you had $1 million today, I mentioned that earlier. If you had $1 million today given to you and you spent $1,000 a day, how many of you think if you tried real hard, you could spend $1,000 a day? Buy new clothes, buy a new car, that'd cover you for a few days, a month or two or three. Buy a new house. If you had $1 million and you spent $1,000 a day, you would be broke in a little less than 3 years. Money goes quick when you're having fun, doesn't it? If you had $1 billion and you spent $1,000 a day, it would last for over 2,500 years. That's how big a billion is. 2.7 billion people approximately live in these 44 countries that we call Eurasia. This ought to break your heart, what I'm going to tell you next. According to the best statistics that we have, only about 11 million of them know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. What an infinitesimally small percentage. How many of you join me and say, God, let your light shine? It is shining. Stories are coming out of people being transformed. If you want to see more about the regions, let me give you a website. Write it on your paper there. It's real easy. AG, Assembly of God, World Missions, agwm.org. If you'll go to the top of the page, once you open it up, you'll see regions. Click on regions. And they'll show you the 7 regions that we have missionaries in, including Eurasia. If you had your Kingdom Partners book, I'm going to go to some names that are in here. So today we're praying for Darren and Sarah Ballard. This is being recorded, so I'm not going to say the country they're in because some of these are sensitive, but if you get a book, you can look and see. Dustin and Natalie Bartholo. Michelle Castle is a young lady from Oklahoma, Oklahoma City area. She's a single lady, and she just recently went as a first-time missionary to the Middle East. And I just want to pray for Michelle today that God would be with her. Dwayne and Lori Danielson were here a few months ago, and Dwayne was here with us during our missions emphasis last year. David and Beth Grant, those are just some of the names that are there. In your prayer guide, there's 32 missionaries listed there. There's a little bit of a story about each one of them. You can pray for one a day. You can pray for all of them every day, however you desire to do that. I want to pray especially today for Darren and Sarah Ballard. I want to pray for Michelle Castle today, those two specifically, both Oklahoma people that are in places of darkness, but God is letting their light shine. Would you join me right now in praying for the countries in Eurasia? There are 44 countries there. If you want to call one out, Afghanistan is in this area. Afghanistan, according to Open Doors, is the second most persecuted country for Christians in the world, only behind North Korea. Libya faces persecution. Pakistan, many others in there have persecution. Can we pray for Christians to be strong? Let me tell you what I hear when I talk to people who are involved with leading ministry to the persecuted church. Most of us probably, and I said us, me in this for sure, if we're being persecuted, we would probably all be praying, take it away, Lord. Make it go away. You know what I hear that most of the persecuted Christians around the world are praying? God, let me have an opportunity to share your grace, even with those who are persecuting me. And God, even through this persecution, may your grace shine even brighter. They're not praying for their will to be done. They're praying for God's will to be done. And I think it's okay if we pray for God to intervene. I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all, but I'm telling you where their heart's at. They're more concerned about the kingdom of God advancing than the suffering they experience stopping. These are brothers and sisters that I'm honored and I'm humbled to call them my brother and sister in Christ. Would you join me right now in praying for Eurasia? And I want you to pray right there where you're seated. I want you to be a part of this prayer with me. Pray what's in your heart. Lord, we lift up these 2.7 billion people, many who have not heard the gospel, few who have heard and received. And we pray that the power of your word would bring transformation. We pray that the power of the Spirit would break the stronghold of darkness. We pray, God, that you would penetrate hearts that have been deceived. And God, you would bring understanding and revelation. Lord, I pray that you would bless those who know you and give them strength in their faith to stand for you. I pray, God, for missionaries in our organization and in other organizations who are there, that you would lead them strategically to the right person at the right time. And I pray, God, that revival would happen in Russia. I pray, God, that revival would happen in Afghanistan. These places where there is darkness, let your light penetrate, we pray, oh God. Lord, I pray for the Ballards today, that they would feel your presence, strengthening them, helping them, leading them. God, be with them, I pray today. For their children, I pray that you would pour out a blessing upon them, God. May their hearts stay tender. May they draw near to you. Lord, I pray for Michelle Castle today, that you would be with her, and God, that she would be strengthened by your power, that her mind would be girded up with the word of God and strengthened against the attack of the enemy. I pray, Lord, that your kingdom would come through the people who are there as people come to know you, repenting of their sins, turning to you as the way of salvation. Lord, we will keep praying and believing. God, we know that you are in control, and we ask that you would pour out your Spirit upon these countries, and God, that people would come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you'll flip over three or four pages in the booklet there, there's a page that has country down the side as we're praying for our nation now. And would we pray for the things that are listed there? The seven things, C for conviction of sin. Lord, open our eyes to see error and to repent. May our nation look to you, God, and may the Holy Spirit work to convict us of sin. Lord, may you pour out your Spirit upon us. May it be transformational. May it be more than just a feeling on a Sunday, but may your outpouring touch us every day of the week. May we keep on continually being filled with your Spirit. Lord, give us understanding and wisdom. Lord, help us to have people who are touched by you, Lord, who are involved in sharing news of our nation, to report things that are good, that are pure, that are just. I pray that you would raise up people who would be honest in their reporting, who would be truthful, and who would report good news more than bad news. I pray that you would do your work, Lord, in that area. Lord, I pray that truth would prevail. I pray, God, that you would confuse the minds of those who attempt to bring things to the forefront that are inaccurate and wrong, to create panic or fear. Lord, I do pray for wisdom, that we would take things that are concerns seriously. but may we always trust in you. And I pray, Lord, that anyone who would try to bring deception, that they would be stopped, Lord, and that truth would prevail. I pray for righteous leaders. Lord, I thank you for men that I know from our state who love you and who honor you and who obey your word. I pray that you would cause them to prosper even politically, Lord. I pray that you would bring up righteous leaders into our state, our nation, and our city and our surrounding areas. Lord, I pray that you would work in my life and each one of us personally, that we would begin to show your love, your grace, to stand for truth, and do all that we can, Lord, to be the light that you want us to be in our nation. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. If you'll flip to the next page, we're going to pray for our nation. It's a very biblical thing to do. For probably many of us, praying for people who have a different political agenda than us may seem difficult, but I think it can be remedied rather quickly and simply through obedience to the word. And the way we pray for those, I would say who we agree with or disagree with, is for God to give them wisdom and for God to give them revelation. And I believe every one of our leaders need that. I believe you and I need that. I always think this way, and maybe it's just me being the idealistic person that I am, but I go back to the New Testament, and I think we know it, but it doesn't probably impact us the way that it did the early church. I did a sermon a few years ago on the Apostle Paul, and the Apostle Paul, I called him the suspicious apostle. The one that nobody believed in. When word first came, well, hey, this guy, he's following the Lord now. And basically the Christian church went, yeah, I'm not so sure about that. Why? Because he had been the persecutor of the church. I say that to say this story. God can bring incredible transformation. There's no limit to what he can do. And I think our assignment is to pray in faith. Would you join me right now in praying for those in our national leadership? If you want to call a specific one by name, I'm not going to mention all of them, but you can. Lord, I pray specifically right now for President Biden. I pray that you would touch him with your enlightenment, your revelation. I pray, God, that he would know you and know your ways. I pray that you would fill his heart with wisdom. I pray, God, that you would put people in his path who would speak truth to him. I pray, Lord, that you would work in his life to bring glory and honor to your name. Lord, your word declares that you are the one who sets up and tears down. You're the one who establishes. And I pray, God, for revival in our nation. I pray, God, for revelation to our leaders. I pray, Lord, that you would do things that would truly be called transformational, radical transformation. Lord, help us to continue to seek your face and never to put our faith in a man or in politics, but our faith is in you. Help us to be vigilant, to do what we can, to be good citizens, and to be involved to the best of our ability. But may we know and be convinced that when it all comes down to the bottom line, our faith in you is what will stand. Lord, I pray that you will give us determination to pray and to believe for our nation. Be with those who serve in the judicial branch of our nation, those who serve across regions of our country and who serve in the states and the communities. I pray, God, that you would fill them with wisdom. I pray, Lord, that you would help them to not be overwhelmed by the situations of life. Lord, in our nation right now, I pray for our friend here at Owosso First Assembly, our national leader, our general superintendent. Would you be with Doug Clay today? Would you give him wisdom and anoint him as he leads the assemblies of God? May he be filled with your spirit, I pray, oh God, with your wisdom. May he be the complete man of God that you have designed him to be. Let your hand be upon him. Lord, I pray for influencers, particularly for Tom Hanks today, that someone would speak to him in a way that would bring awareness of who you are. Lord, I've heard stories in the last few months of people in the secular world who are rethinking life and looking to see more about who you are, God. I pray that you would give them a hunger. I pray, God, that you would put the right people there to speak into their lives. And I pray that your word and your spirit would be impacted upon them. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray for our state now and for our local community here for Owosso today. If you're from a different community around town, maybe you're from Collinsville or Ooligah or Skytook or Tulsa or Broken Arrow or wherever you're from, you can pray. Catoosa, I'll throw that one in too. You can pray for your community as I pray right now. We're going to pray for our state. We're going to pray for our local communities. God, I thank you for our governor who calls for churches to come together and pray for our state. I thank you for his wife, who is a strong woman of God and who's committed to leading our state in times of seasons of prayer. Lord, I pray for our lieutenant governor, that you would be with him, God. And I pray for our senators, the U.S. senators from our state, for James Langford and for Jim Inhofe, that you would be with them, God, and lead them in right thinking. Pray for Mike Hunter, our attorney general. I pray for our Department of Education, all who serve there. Would you help them, Lord? And would you give them direction and guidance? Would you lead them in a direction that is pleasing to you? Lord, I pray for the representatives that we have that serve in Washington, for Kevin Hearn and for Mark Wayne Mullen, for Frank Lucas, for Tom Cole. And I pray, God, that you would help them as they look to you. For Stephanie Bice, Lord, I pray that you would be with them today. I thank you, Lord, for Mark Wayne Mullen, for his love for you and commitment to you. And I pray you would cause him to prosper and to grow in favor. Use him, Lord, for the advancement of your kingdom. Lord, I pray for Owosso and for Warren Lear, our city manager. Lord, I pray for one of our friends in the faith. Lord, for one of our brothers that serves over at Bethel, that you would be with Bill Askell today and that you would bless his leadership and bless that church. Lord, I thank you that here in Owosso, there is a place of compassion at the Baptist Children's Home. And I pray that you would bless the kids who are there. I pray that you would bless those who serve them. And I pray, God, they would feel your strength. I pray they would feel your presence. Lord, I pray for every one of the children who are there. May they encounter you in your fullness and your grace, oh God. And I give you praise and thanks for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to pray for our church now. We're going to pray for church staff. We're going to pray for deacons. We're going to pray for those who work in leadership in our church. If you serve in any kind of group leading that, whether it's a Sunday school class or a Wednesday night or a community group or whatever it is that you're doing in ministry, I want to pray right now for God to anoint and bless your efforts. And you know, there's a lot of you that are involved in ministry that's outside of these walls. I thank God for that. I thank God that you're letting your light shine when it's not in an official church capacity. For those of you that are involved in a place where you're letting your light shine and you're helping those in need and you're letting the love of Jesus shine through you, I mean this word as sincere as I can say it. I bless you in the name of Jesus. I'm so thankful for what you're doing. Would you maybe look at one name on that list or a couple of names there as the Lord prompts you? Would you pray for our church right now that God would give wisdom and favor and blessing and help us to do what he has called us to do? Would you join me in that prayer? Father, I thank you for the people that you've placed in our church. For those who are here in leadership, I pray that you would give them strength and wisdom. I pray that you would guide the steps that they take. I pray that you would give them divine appointments. I pray, Lord, that you would use them to be disciple makers, to be developers of those who do the work of the ministry, that it would not be limited to only those in leadership, but as a church, we would all be committed to doing the work of the ministry as Ephesians chapter 4 spells out for us. Lord, I thank you for those who serve with me as deacons, who involve themselves in ministry, in prayer, in serving. I thank you, Lord, for the blessing they are in my life. And I pray, God, that you would bless each one of them and their families. Lord, I thank you for each Sunday school teacher and every worker, for those who teach and serve on Wednesday nights, for those who open up their home for people to come and fellowship and pray together and develop community on Sunday nights, for those who serve every day in a place of ministry. Even though it may not be a church, they're lifting up the name of Jesus. They're helping people, bringing glory to your name, O God. Lord, may the influence of our church continue to expand across our community, across our state, across our nation and around the world. Let your hand be upon this church, God, that it may advance your kingdom and accomplish your will, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Two more things we're going to pray for before we conclude today. We're going to pray now for ourselves. How many of you have discovered it's easier to pray about other people sometimes than it is to pray about yourself? I can get my list out of all the people I'm saying, God, help this one because you know they got a problem. But there are times that God wants us to look at ourselves and let the Holy Spirit start searching in us. So you got some things there at the bottom of that page asking us to pray for ourselves, for the Holy Spirit, to make sure that we recognize how much God loves us and cares for us, that His presence is with us wherever we go and whatever we do. How many of you need to be reminded of that occasionally? You know why? Because the devil is going to constantly tell you that you're alone, you're isolated, because that's what he's trying to do to you, because that's when he can attack you. But when you stand in the power and the understanding of God's presence, it gives you strength for victory. Pray for the Holy Spirit to give you eyes to see how to live as a disciple maker in your home, in your neighborhood, your school or workplace, your church, and wherever God places you. Pray for the ability to love across divides. Pray for God to give you deeper faith and wider influence. God's given us the ministry of reconciliation. We are ambassadors of Christ. Would you just right now pray for yourself, that God would help you to grow, to develop in areas that maybe you're not strong in, but to get stronger through the power of the Spirit, the power of the Word, the influence of those around you, that He would craft you into the person that you are designed to be. God, I thank you that you are working on us continually, that you are transforming us so that we are now conformed into the image of Jesus, not conformed to the world, but becoming like Jesus. Lord, sometimes we think that's just going to be a simple prayer and process, but the reality is sometimes you have to get the sandpaper out. You have to use things around us to work on us, to develop us. And Lord, we are simply saying that we want to be like you, whatever it takes. And Lord, even if we face difficulty, we will do it joyfully, knowing that tribulation produces within us growth and strength. Lord, I thank you that you are working in every situation to bring glory to your name, to bring honor to who you are. We glorify your name today, O God. We honor you as being the name that is above all names. We worship you today, O Lord. We thank you for your faithfulness. Would you stand up right now and just take a moment dedicating yourself to the Lord? Lord, I give you my life. Use me, Lord, for the advancement of your kingdom. Place me where I need to be. Do what you need to do in my life, God, that I may be useful to your kingdom, we pray. Thank you, Lord.